Welcome to Numerix video blog. I'm your host, Jim Jocko. With me today, Denny Yu of Numerix Client Solutions Group. How are you, Denny?
Good. How are you?
Very good. Denny, I want to talk about an article that came out September 2nd, 2013 by Matt Cameron of Risk Magazine titled Replacement Costs Add to OTC Pricing Upheaval. And if you haven't read it and you're in the market, it's definitely say a must read. And it's introducing basically rating triggers back again and the development of RVA. And for those who are unfamiliar with rating triggers, they came back into the spotlight really around Enron. And then from there were highlighted through the Rating Agency Reform Act of 2009. And we're now seeing them again. And there's a lot of interesting positions on this in terms of the role of rating triggers within OTC derivatives valuations. So Denny, really what I want to jump into a little bit is, you know, we all know what rating triggers are, but explain this concept of RVA and why it is so controversial.
Sure. So the replacement valuation adjustment is really a metric to measure downgrade triggers. And the downgrade trigger is typically a clause you would find in the CSA or credit support annex that is negotiated between banks and their counterparty clients. And what the clause really dictates is in the event of a downgrade to a certain rating level for that bank, the counterparty, typically the end client, has the ability to force a closeout. And that means that the bank will have to close out that position and replace that position with another bank, which means they actually have to find another counterparty to step in and take over that transaction. Now, from a risk perspective, it's hard to measure because we take into account potential downfall triggers. It takes into account the likelihood of defaults, the likelihood of the end client exercising that option to force closeout and replacement, and ultimately, the big part of this article, which is really well written around this, is the fact that these downgrade triggers exist typically for concentrated sets of banks around different types of asset classes. So an example in the article was around inflation swaps, which has a lot of banks in the UK that have built-in downgrade triggers with their clients. And the fact remains that in the event of a financial crisis, such as the one we've seen in 2008, most of these banks will go through downgrades, and a lot of these triggers can then be kicked into effect, and as a result, you would see bid-ask spreads explode as a result of counterparties and banks trying to replace a lot of these positions.
But how is the market involved? You know, you think about a couple of years ago, you know, your average bank rating was probably in, you know, probably AA range. And we've seen, you know, continued pressure, downward rating pressure, and the triggers were really coming in that double B range. There's not a lot of room here, especially if you're looking at any point in time a multi-notch downgrade. So it's clear on the systemic risk, but how should practitioners be thinking or preparing as for those institutions that might be getting close to a trigger, or, you know, in the event of a multi-notch downgrade, you know, what kind of defense mechanism could you have in place?
Well, it's a difficult question. So you can think of it from the end client side, you can think of it from the bank side. If you look at the history of why these downgrade triggers exist in the CSAs, it was really to gain market share. So during times where these banks were highly rated, it was a free option that was offered to end clients to win market share. And I don't think there was really a lot of workaround or belief that many years from those initial transactions, we'd be at the rating levels that we see banks at today. So that was really not something that was actively managed. Now it comes into the forefront because we are in a different environment. Banks are at much lower ratings than they were in the past decade. And as a result, banks have to manage this potential risk. End clients who are still looking to be able to exercise these options or be able to still embed them in new swaps transactions are looking to have this type of exit strategy. How do banks manage this today? That's a big question mark. So a lot of inputs go into this. We've talked about in the past calculating CVA and DVA, and those require some assumptions. RVA requires even more assumptions. It basically is managing and estimating default likelihood of the own bank, and you can do that through bond spreads and credit spreads, but you have to also measure the likelihood of your end client actually exercising that option, and they may choose not to do that or to do that depending on the benefits for them, and they may find it very difficult to find that estimation. So,
well, we've done a lot really around the release of the new standard CSA and the reduction of optionality. Has this been addressed in the new standard CSA?
In the new standard CSE, you don't actually see much on the downgrade triggers. We've moved to a smaller set of currencies that can be posted as collateral, a smaller set of eligible collateral securities that can be posted. So we're reducing some of the optionality around the currency that can be posted, and certainly around the downgrade rating triggers. But as you said, the standardized CSA is going to take a while to roll out, and it's something that will take several years to roll out. And a lot of banks are trying to negotiate with their counterparties and their end clients to be able to move into that regime. Till then, these banks still have to deal with this potential RVA risk.
Now, let's go on the flip side for a second here, because we're really kind of talking in the context of the major dealer, and you talked a little bit about those on the other side of trade and the counterparty. We're also going to start running into the same problem that we've seen in the CDS market, right? So you have very liquid names, highly rated entities, but there's, on the other side of the trade, there aren't a lot of public credit ratings for smaller type firms, or where there are bond spreads or credit spreads, they're not actively traded. So we're in interpolation of a probability of default. How is that going to get managed and looked at, or is that just going to be managed through traditional CVA type charges or DVA type type replacements?
I think you're going back to really around the counterparty credit risk of the corporate clients, the pension clients, where you don't have a lot of public information around their bond spreads or there's no traded CDS on their name. In most cases, banks will have their internal rating models where they actually map either proxy indexes for credits, or they'll have their actually own rating models that determine default probabilities of those corporate issuers.
So last question, so the spaghetti bowl of acronyms is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Who should be worried about RVA? Who's the practitioner in the bank that should be reading this article today and be adjusting this into their thought process?
Well, this is a fundamentally a pricing issue. So the front office team that's valuing the trades, managing, entering into these types of trades, they'll be the ones who have the deal with most of the headache around these valuation adjustments. The middle office risk side is starting to get their hands around and heads around what all the different XVA charges are, and that's plenty of work to do with before even trying to measure and monitor the RVA.
Denny, I want to thank you so much. And you know, the bottom line is 1 + 1 + 1 + 1 equals EVA, the economic valuation adjustment, and getting to that true P&L. Clearly, the valuation process continues to evolve, and it's touching all elements of the institution. And we're going to continue to stay on that topic. And we want to hear from you, and make sure we're covering the elements that you want to hear about. And follow us along on Twitter at NX Analytics or on LinkedIn to stay on top of everything that we're coming to market with. Denny, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And have a good day.